here.
Oh, it said recording in progress. D'accord. Voila.
And enable auto transcription. Should I call you Dr. Merriman?
My name's John. Sorry.
Okay.
Dr. Mary. No, I mean, commandment. It's
Merriman,
but my name is John.
Merriman. Okay.
Yeah, that's my name. It's John. It's my name. John Merriman.
So how are you doing tonight? Other than that, it's late there where you are.
Yeah, I watched baseball all day and I rode a little bit and watched a Red Sox doubleheader. And then I watched a Mets game and, you know, type on the machine and that's it.
Yeah.
My kids are, as I say, my son is down with seeing his girlfriend. So he's downtown in New Haven and my daughter is on the way back from New York. So I'm just here by myself.
Well, that's good then. We can hang out and have a little fun this evening. Welcome, everyone. It's good to see you. It's 7:31, so why don't we get started? And it's very late for John Merriman. He's on the East Coast, and so it's 10:30 out there. And, you know, maybe he doesn't want to have to stay too late. We'll see how
things go tonight
for him. Okay, that's great. And I don't know if you guys know, but I am in Mexico City. Tonight, and so it's 9:30 here, and so we have three time zones that we're all reaching across and
cool.
Making things work. So anyway, so just a brief introduction of Dr. Merriman. John, he's a Charles Seymour Professor of History at Yale, author of many books, including his most well-known A History of Modern Europe Since the Renaissance, a survey text for undergraduate history classes at many American universities and colleges. He was raised in Oregon. He went to an all-boys Jesuit high school.
And survived.
And survived. Yeah. I taught for a few years at a Catholic high school. I know what that's like. His favorite music is the Rolling Stones. And that's why if you tuned in earlier, you heard the Rolling Stones as an honor of our guest tonight, and I'm looking here at his Wikipedia page, and it says he's never written a thing without a record on. And so we're going to find out what your favorite Rolling Stones hit is here in a moment.
Give me Shelter.
Oh yeah, it's good. I like Waiting on a Friend. That's my favorite. His recent books include The Dynamite Club, Have a Bombing in Fin de Siècle, Paris Ignited the Age of Modern Terror, and he has several other books. He's been on tons of doctoral committees. He's been awarded up and down by Yale and by, I think I read something that, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong, but from the Ministry of Poland for your work, and has taught in residence at universities in France as well as Yale, has his PhD from the University of Michigan, and all around very interesting person and accessible person. And I have to tell all of you that when I started to put together this lecture series topic for this semester, I thought it would be something nice to do something of Mozart and a little bit on the Enlightenment. That's kind of something that's been coming up in the news lately and people have been talking about. And so this is our ninth lecture in that series. And I started to look around on YouTube to see, you know, who was giving lectures on those kinds of things. And I found John's YouTube lecture on an introduction actually to the Enlightenment. But he has a whole ton of lectures. You got to go check them out because they're so super cool. And I'd listen to it. I go, man, it would be great if we could just, you know, maybe talk to this guy if he would. And on a lark, I just sent him an email and he agreed to Zoom in with us tonight. So, you know, here you guys, you get a chance to meet a Yale professor in live person and a chance to hear what he has to say about a few things. So we may ramble a bit tonight or we may not, but I'm gonna ask John a few questions and maybe get started and he'll have a chance to talk to you a little bit about some of the things he's working on right now. But first, you know, John, we've been looking at Mozart and kind of how he was struggling a bit on how he was going to deal with the ideas of the Enlightenment. Of course, he had to sort of keep a good face for those in power and all of that. But, you know, he became a Mason, and he was working in that way. And that's certainly part of the philosophy of that time period. And today I reviewed your lecture, and you were talking about six ways that the Enlightenment mattered. And I wondered if you might just recap that a little bit for us and tell us a little bit what you think about that.
Well, I can't remember what I said, but one of the ways that Enlightenment matters is because it had a big influence on the French Revolution and on important people in the French Revolution. Robespierre, you know, born in Arras, was influenced by the French Revolution. And, you know, Rousseau's general will was something that came up over and over again in the speeches of Robespierre in the National Assembly. And, you know, the Enlightenment did matter. And it mattered in the counter-revolution, which I'll talk about in a minute, because the counter-revolution was the work of people who didn't believe in the Enlightenment and certainly did not believe in the French Revolution. But one of the most interesting things for me, and I mean, just as repeating what, Steve, what you probably heard me say in one of the Yale YouTube lectures, is that one of the most interesting things about the Enlightenment, it falls in the realm of the social history of ideas. You know, when I was first starting out, you know, my graduate work at Mighty Maize and Blue at Michigan all these decades ago, you know, the intellectual history, which I don't do, I'm a social historian, political historian, was basically the history of ideas, where you had, you know, one idea floating around in the sky and it hits on another idea, and, you know, another idea bounces down as the result, or out there somewhere as a result of them, these two ideas hooking up. And my late great friend, Peter Gay, was one of the first to say that we have to study the social history of ideas. And my good friend, Bob Darnton, who taught at Princeton for decades and then at Harvard and is now retired, is one of the people who went out and did it, because he was interested in how enlightened ideas got into France in publications that are legal to print in France, and how they get into France printed in Switzerland, in Neuchâtel or other places, or from the Pays-Bas, from the Netherlands. And so that really became the social history of ideas. But to take that one step further, one step earlier, it's interesting to know how enlightened ideas got around. If you take Diderot's encyclopedia, you know, copies of it turned up in South Africa, in St. Petersburg, in Philadelphia, in the United States, in New York, in the United States, you know, here and there, well, in London, of course, too, and even in Northern England. I mean, how many people could afford Diderot's encyclopedia, and how many people ever read it? It's the second is impossible to tell. But taking France as an example, how did the ideas of the philosophes, that is the enlightened thinkers, Rousseau and Diderot and Montesquieu earlier and lots of other ones, how did they get around? And they did really in France in three kind of ways. There were conduits that people learned about the Enlightenment. And one would be the Masonic lodges. The Masonic lodges began, I mean, what the hell do I know about the Masonic lodges? I wrote about them. I can't remember the thing I wrote, but really begin in Scotland in the 16th century, or is it the 15th century? It doesn't matter. But Masonic lodges were everywhere in France, in Paris and in provincial capitals like Rouen and Lyon and Marseille and Bordeaux and Dijon and other places. And, you know, in the United States as well, one of the horrors of my childhood was having to go to Masonic Lodge, to dancing school in the seventh grade. And you see these big lumbering buildings. And I don't know if the Masons still exist in this country. There's a Masonic Lodge in New Haven, Connecticut, that's now an insurance company. But Masonic Lodges had people who believed in the philosoph, read the philosoph, and discussed the philosoph. And so that's terribly important. And some of these dudes ended up being important in the revolution. The second way was salon. I mean, a salon is a French word so important, it became an English word too. And if you ever go into the Palais Royal in Paris and on a sunny day, and you see all that grass and all these strange ways they're destroying the area with putting up these, you know, white and black poles all over the damn place. But you can imagine what it was like in the 1750s, 60s, and 70s when it was hot, and that women who hosted salon would invite their guests, most of whom were male, to go outside and sit in the lawn, or simply to sit and drink, that's a good idea, in their apartment, big elegant apartment houses. And there you would they would discuss the philosoph. And there would be philosoph, many of them, you know, most of them never made it, the kind of Voltaire called la canaille, the rabble, the scribblers. You know, they wanted to be invited to the salon to present their ideas, however modest they were, or bad they were, or indifferent they were, the ideas. But the salon was one way that Enlightenment ideas spread. And a third was académie. Now, academy has nothing at all to do with the university. You think of, you know, an academy being a university. That's not what it was. An academy was kind of a gathering of erudites. That was how we would say in French, erudite. And they were they tended to be intellectuals. Some priests participated in these gatherings. There were some business people. They were all sorts of different. Varieties and these academies could be found in very many places in France, and they offered prizes, contests writing an essay about a certain topic. Robespierre entered one of those contests, and these academies still exist. There's an Academy of Ardèche. We live in Ardèche in southeastern France. We're, you know, permanent residents there, They meet up. I mean, I'm a member of one of these academies. I've never gone to one of their meetings, but they still exist. But there's nothing to do with academic life. But they would invite, you know, various Enlightenment figures in, the big guys and the not so big guys, in to talk and to answer questions. So those are three of the ways that Enlightenment thought got around in France. And there would be, I imagine, because a lot of they had correspondence in the German states and in Great Britain, and one can imagine Enlightenment works being discussed possibly in English coffee houses. I don't know, but that's really the social history of ideas.
Now, you mentioned in your lecture, you were talking about the Grub Street hacks, the writers, and the role that they played. You know, you mentioned, you know, like Voltaire, Rousseau, these writers that were, everybody knew, and they were wealthy, but these other writers were kind of, you know, would kind of scrabble around, and they'd write these things that about the elite that were not very nice, and all of this kind of thing. I thought that was very interesting.
Well, that's not my discovery at all. It's my good friend Bob Darton, who did a lot of work on this, on the Grub Street hacks. You know, those, as I repeat what I said before, that Voltaire called la canaille. Now, Rousseau and Voltaire, who hated each other, they both die in 1778. And the kinds of writers that Darton has written a lot about were those who wanted to be Voltaire, and they wanted to be, you know, Rousseau, or they wanted to be Diderot or Montesquieu. And in order to survive, they wrote libelles. They wrote, denunciations of the monarchy. You better be careful in what they're publishing there. They wrote scatological literature, denunciations of nobles, and trying to imagine what was going on, you know, among the 10,000 nobles all chasing their wives and mistresses around at Versailles. And if they had any effect, in Paris, if you know Paris, a lot of them, and there's about a couple hundred of them actually, because they all were applying for money all the time. So they're applying for pension, for fric, money. And so a lot of them lived around Odéon, actually. In fact, that's where Marat published this later, his L'Ami du Peuple, his newspaper, The Friend of the People. So what did they accomplish? I mean, they never made the big time, that's for sure. But their denunciations, their libel, their denunciations of the monarchy, their denunciations in particular of that woman who was indelicately called the Austrian whore, that is Marie Antoinette, led to a kind of a demeaning, a dissing of the monarchy. And arguably portraying Louis the 16th as this cuckolded king who preferred to go around and repairing clocks. Louis the 16th liked to repair clocks and do carpentry. This may have had a role in undermining faith in the monarchy. And if you put this together with the influence of the big thinkers of the big Enlightenment on revolutionaries who come to power, most of them in the Radical Republic in 1792 in France, the Enlightenment does have an influence on the French Revolution.
I thought it was really interesting too how you talked about how ideas got around, not just only in France, right? I mean, as you were going through your lecture, you were talking about how kind of the social aspect of how ideas get transmitted around and then things can happen. And you talked about how literature from other countries would be snuck into France because of course anything that was derogatory would have been illegal.
Yeah, or Enlightenment literature, because there was a censor, a big censor, and you had to be careful what you publish. You're going to end up in prison. And so a lot of the Enlightenment literature, including the big stuff, was published in the Netherlands and in Switzerland. And part of the social history of ideas is how did this stuff get from Neuchâtel, where a lot of it was printed, into France? And Bob Darnton did a lot of work at Neuchâtel. He got fortune. I mean, he deserved the luck that he got. He found all the records of people writing the printing company in Neuchâtel asking for Enlightenment literature or would-be Enlightenment literature or pornography or whatever. But so how does this stuff actually physically get in? You had in early modern times and right through the 19th century, you had peddlers and they went around Europe carrying these huge leather sacks on their backs. If you can imagine a medicine ball in a gym and multiply that by 8 or 9 or 10 times, and they would be crossing the mountains, crossing the Jura Mountains. Let's say they're coming from Switzerland, and these peddlers were carrying Enlightenment literature. They were also, when they got into France, they were carrying, images of the Virgin Mary and of saints who had wrought miracles in Spain, or images of famous generals. And this was before Napoleon, but there were famous generals before that, and pins and pens and things that ordinary people couldn't find terribly easier. So they're dodging the equivalent of the gendarme, we call the maréchaussée in those days. So imagine carrying these things all the way from Switzerland across the Jura Mountains and then going to, maybe to Chaumont, which is kind of a boring town in the old mound, and maybe dropping off their big sack there, and then somebody else picks it up and takes it to the next stop. And that's how things got in. Or they go through from the Netherlands through the southern Netherlands, which is now Belgium, again dodging the Maréchaussée, and they get into France and deliver these goods, these books, and these other goods to buyers in France. So
you also mentioned
the social history of ideas.
You also mentioned the law briefs, right? That was a place of record that you could bring up things. It'd have to become some kind of printed record, right?
Another good friend, David Bell, has written a lot about that, the role of lawyers who were infused, many of them, with Enlightenment ideas, not all of them, but there were a couple big, controversial cases in France, involving the Jansenists. Jansenists were, a sort of a sect the Catholic Church, named after an obscure bishop of Ypres, I think it's from Ypres, in Belgium, and they were crushed like grapes by ultimately by the king. But they were, you know, persecuted, obviously, by this coalition of the Pope and the King. But a lot of the lawyers at that time, and the two big surges of this Jansenism, one is about 1713, 1750, and one is later in the middle of the century, believed that they were being treated unfairly by the monarchy. And they weren't Jansenists, these lawyers, but they said, this isn't right that they should be treated like that. And so they could, you couldn't write just stuff denouncing the King, but you could write, the lawyers could write legal briefs that could be distributed and were published in some cases, you know, 10,000 copies of these things were published. And later, you know, there are cases, and you know, that there's another big incident that had to do with freeing the grain trade, and these legal briefs got around. And one of the things that ultimately they do is they pose the term la nation, the nation, and it emerges as a potentially alternative way of viewing sovereignty. And so gradually there's a growth of identity of a French nation. And you know, if in 1789 on July 14th, there weren't 10 people in France who were Republicans, not in American sense, thank God, but in people who believed in a republic, by 1792, it was easy, 1791, it was easy for lots of people to imagine that even a reformed monarchy wasn't enough. That you could have a republic, and the sense of a nation then wins out as his alternative vision of sovereignty. And so these ideas get around in his legal briefs. Just to leap into another, you know, to another part of Europe, this is true at the end of the 19th century in Russia, in Imperial Russia, because you better watch it. You better not, you know, denounce the King or any of the, you know, the hangers-on or any of the zillions of, you know, the police or whatever. But when they put these folks on trial for sedition, lawyers could publish these legal briefs. And so ideas get around. So again, this falls into the whole idea of how do ideas get around? How do people learn about what's going on? And so, I mean, it's interesting. It's fascinating.
I think it's really interesting that to all the underground things that were kind of happening to push things along. So cool. let me give you, you know, some of the points that you talked about in your lecture, and maybe you could say just something very briefly about, because I want to get
I
on.
I don't remember what I said in these lectures. I'm a long time ago.
I know. I'm going to give you some prompts here, and you can whatever comes to mind.
I want to
also move to what you're working on now, because that is an incredibly fascinating work, and I want, you know, everyone to be
merci.
Get a chance to hear about that. So you talked about here's one: the weakened role of the Catholic Church as something that came out of the Enlightenment.
Yeah, but it starts before the Enlightenment too. I mean, it's a great topic. The word de-Christianization has two senses. One is that when the Radical Republic and the French Revolution begins melting down church bells to transform the metal into cannons and eliminates the calendar. They put in a revolutionary calendar, so there's no more Sundays. There's no more months. There's no more May or June. Germinal is a time period, and they're working against the Catholic Church and its role as a counter-revolutionary force, because that's what it was. Religion was the most important, without any question, determinant of whether people would be for or against the French Revolution. But the church after the revolution and after Napoleon, the Catholic Church said, well, it's all the fault of the Enlightenment people. They were destroying or working against that old time religion. But the other sense of de-Christianization is more important. And that is that it's way before the Enlightenment. Well, at least by the end of the 17th century, there were parts of France in which organized religion had a much lesser role in private life than before. And the process of de-Christianization really moves through the 18th century, right through the 19th century. And it's regionally specific, because in the 19th century, just to take that as an example, there are parts of France that were still very heavily practicing religion, not as much as Poland, where I go all the time, but still very much so. Brittany being one, Auvergne being another one, the North, you know, Flemish speaking, much of it in that time, Alsace and parts of Lorraine, yes. But there are other areas in which that wasn't the case. And a really great historian that I had the pleasure of having lunch or dinner with a few times near where we live in Ardèche in the south near our village, a guy called Michel Vauvel went out to study de-Christianization in Provence. And he was able to demonstrate that it wasn't the revolution that eroded a considerable part of the role of the church in private life, that had already happened, it had already begun. Now, how are you going to, just briefly, how are you going to prove that? Well, if religious vocations decline, that's one reason. If people stop leaving money to have 1,000 masses said for the repose of their eternal soul, that's another, and start leaving money to lay, you know, hospices and things like that, hospice in the French sense. If people stop naming their children after saints, I lived a long time in Limoges. I wrote a book on Limoges a long time ago. And there, the big saints were Martial and Léonard. And you can look up the number of people that were named Martial and Léonard, and declines rapidly. Or if people, you're supposed to in the Catholic Church, have your babies baptized within 3 days. And over the course of the 19th century, it goes from 3 days to 10 days to a month to 2 to 3 months to a year to never in many cases. So that's another example. So, and bishop's sermons talking about the dark secrets, that bishop's sermons were published every month. What are the dark secrets? Birth control. And that's one reason, if you look at Burgundy or Auvergne, they had huge numbers of children. If you look at the southwest of France or the Ile-de-France or the Limousin, very few children. We had friends, one of whom is deceased now. They owned a cafe. That's how I know them. I know other people from cafes. And they grew up with 13 and 12 brothers and sisters, respectively. They're from just élevés dans la misère, just absolutely poor people from Auvergne. And they had all of these children. But if you went into other parts of France, people didn't have a lot of children. So that tells you something's going on. So that's part of de-Christianization. And it was this ongoing process that you still see in France today. You know, France, 95% of the population, really it's 90%, are nominally Catholic. 5% Protestant, a couple hundred thousand people who are Jewish, and then, you know, about 5% Muslim population. But in France, the average priest is 70 years old. One quarter of all the priests are 80 years old. And there aren't masses in many parts. In most villages in France, there are not masses. People have to, the mass may alternate between, you know, between four different villages, four different churches, or people have to go to drive to a village nearby. So that's part of this ongoing process. In France now today, only 17% read, you know, the poll that was in Libé, in Libération, maybe 2 years ago, 17% of the people only say that they're Catholic, and only 5% are practicing Catholics, and only 5% go to Mass on Sundays. So that's part of this long process of de-Christianization. And you know, I mentioned Poland because I went to Poland once, you know, au temps de camarades, in the time of the comrades, and I was never again until 2006. And I've been to Poland 50, not 15, but 50 times since then, because I do a lot of, we look at manuscripts, we take people around, we drink a lot of vodka, you know, I like Poland. I hate the government now. Law and justice, it's a bunch of disasters, a bunch of just, you know, xenophobic, you know, crazy people. And it's the right wing of the Catholic Church that's behind all of this, but that's another story. But one of my friends in Poland told me that the problem in Poland, one of them is there's so many young priests. Well, for Catholics in France, there aren't any more priests. So this is the long run of de-Christianization. That was a long answer to your excellent question.
Yeah, it's wonderful. Well, so yeah, then you talked about the next point, which was the replacement of a kind of spiritual code of ethics with a secular code of ethics.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And I don't know if you have anything to say about that, but then you also talked about developing a critical analysis, a way of experiencing things through critical analysis, or I suppose that's an extension of the scientific method that was coming out.
Yeah, but it's also an extension of the Enlightenment, because the Enlightenment, you know, the whole aspect, the whole basis of the Enlightenment was to learn, to know, and to teach. And here again, I'm thinking of my late friend Peter Gay, who has these two classic volumes on the Enlightenment published a whole hell of a long time ago in the late 1960s when he was at Columbia before he came to Yale in 1969. And there was idea of learning, of rational thought, rational inquiry. It builds on the scientific revolution, that's for sure. And it also is something that you know, obviously affects me and what I do in my little career here, is they had a strong belief in history and that things were getting better. That's what the Enlightenment said. The Catholic Church would tell you, and I'm not dissing the Catholics. I went to a Catholic grade school, a Jesuit high school. I still give them money because, you know, I was lucky in some ways to have gone to that school because, you know, I had a difficult time at home and all that. So I give them money. So I'm not dissing the Catholic Church, but that part of the Catholic Church. But the Catholic Church said this is a valley of tears, and if you behave yourself, then ultimately all will be well in heaven. I don't know if that means if you're drinking in heaven, drinking Burgundy wine all the time, and I'd be with that, you know, instead of Rotgut wine. But it was an optimistic, not an optimistic view of the world. And the Enlightenment thinkers said that's not right. That we can study and see that things are getting better. And we must work hard to make that's the case in the future. And they weren't all atheists, and only one or two of them were. Some were deists, believed that God is in this couch or God is in that television set or, you know, God is on your desk in Mexico City. And others were sort of more kind of normal religious types, and other people didn't pay much attention to organized religion, but still thought it was important to have. You know, they had different ideas. And Voltaire is the most obvious of the anti-clericals. But what they had in common is that they were against the kind of the role of the Catholic Church in public life being a dominant thing. Yeah.
So, progressivism seems to be a part of that. And even today, we tend to point to things that have happened in France that are influencing progressivism today. And I'm just wondering if you see that as an extension of what was happening in the Enlightenment.
Well, I mean, that's very hard to say because, it's very long over the back. It took, you know, women didn't have the right to vote in France until 1945. So that was a very, very long struggle. And one of sad ironies of that is a lot of the socialists particularly didn't want women to have the right to vote, which seems to fly in the face of their normally progressive comportment. The reason was it's because there's a big gap in the number of women who went to church more than men. And the socialists thought, well, the priest will just whisper in the confessional and tell women who to vote for. And so, you know, it's hard to say that this progress came racing along rapidly after the French Revolution if women didn't have the right to vote until 1945. Or Jews, for example, Jews got civil rights at the time of the French Revolution. And again, you know, these things are reinforced in the Second French Republic and also in 1870 by a law. But nonetheless, I mean, progress wasn't always there. Take July 1942, when the Jews of the Marais, which had the largest concentration of the Jews from Poland and from Russia, many of whom didn't speak French very well, whole wonderful collection of, you know, anarchists and socialists and just interesting people, they lived in Belleville or lived in Montmartre. When they're arrested in 1942, they were arrested by the French police. And the German police wouldn't be happy to do it, but the French police said, we want to show you that we're independent. We will go get these people. And they end up, as you know, in the Veldiv, which is an old bicycle track no longer exists. It wasn't too far from the Eiffel Tower. And then they're sent to Drancy or to PCVA, which were two transit camps. And then they're sent off to die. And they were arrested by the French police. The Enlightenment people said, well, things are going to get better and better and better. But in France, you know, there were times where things didn't go terribly well at all. And if you think that things are going to get better automatically, think of 1914 to 1918, when a battle over real estate takes the life of 1.5 million French soldiers, 1.5 million. And that all the French men who went into the army between early August 1914 and Christmas 1915. Half of them were dead by the end of 1915. To say nothing of all the people coughing up their lungs with poison gas from Ypres, or mutilated. There's still in the Paris metro, there's still signs that that seats are reserved for mutilated again, for for soldiers who have been wounded in the war. So it's France is not, as much as I love France and I spent half my adult life there, it's not always been a straight linear movement, right, of progress in the country. I love too much. Yeah. Besides another disaster, we've had all the wines. We're going to have no wine this year because it was so cold that all the vineyards have been destroyed in the Bordelais and in Bourgogne and in the Côte d'Aron and everywhere. So, but that's just
tragic.
That's a flip of the day. It's nothing to do with real tragedies that I've enumerated.
Yeah. Well, and the last, we caught most of these in kind of the conversation, but the last, the six ways of that you had mentioned that the Enlightenment mattered was the move from despotism to absolutism. And you kind of hit this a little bit earlier, but I thought it was really interesting, and maybe you would just mention it again, about in 1789, there were not too many people at all who were really had any idea about what a republic was or even supported it. And just 4 years later, the tide had completely changed and gone the other direction.
Okay, absolutism, people would accept absolutism. We still tend to write about enlightened absolutism, et cetera, et cetera. But even the people who supported absolutism, even within the monarchy, were against despotism. And yet what happens in the 1780s is that there's more there are more accusations that the government is behaving despotically. And the most obvious example or most well-known example are the so-called lettres de cachet, which is that these are letters that could the king never signed letters, but that one of the king's officials or just somebody who knew somebody could get a letter putting someone in jail in Vincennes or even in the famous Bastille for no particular reason, and not they would know how long they were going to stay there. So the sense that France, the monarchy, was risking going from absolutism to despotism was terribly important just before and during the French Revolution. And the other is the return of the term of la nation, of the nation, because it was bad news for the monarch that their police reports in April of and May of 1789 that very ordinary people in the bars in the poorer regions of eastern Paris were drinking to the nation, la nation. And again, it became this kind of alternative way of imagining sovereignty. And it's something that got around very, very quickly, especially when the government was seen to be behaving despotically, and there were all these rumors that the monarch was going to bring troops. All the troops were going to come pouring into Paris and end all the good things that were going on. And so these two factors are important. It seemed to be despotic behavior, and it wasn't too much longer. The king tries to escape, and he's toast. He's French toast, to make a terrible pun. When he tries to escape, and he's stopped at Varennes up near the Belgian border. And when he's brought back, the National Guard turns their back to him as he's brought back in a carriage, and a sign of contempt for him. And to use one of my favorite expressions in French, it's la fin des haricots, it's the end of the green beans. That means, it wasn't too much longer. He's going to put his head through that little window and be guillotined on the 21st of January, 1793, followed by Marie Antoinette. Voila.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think we did the Enlightenment.
I hope so. I hope I don't enlighten anybody, but I'm talking about this stuff.
It's fun talking about this stuff. I have to tell everyone that earlier today I said, John, we'll just have a kind of a conversation, like maybe we're, you know, having drinks or dinner or something like that. He goes, yeah, I can't imagine talking about that stuff over dinner, right?
But, well, I wish we're having drinks right now, but we're not.
Yeah. Well, okay. So this, I'd like for you to, if you don't mind, tell everybody a little bit about what you're working on now, and because it, it's just a little bit that I read about it. It just wants me to pick up your book. Yeah.
Yeah. Matthew, the last couple of years I've been teaching a course called The Dark Years, which is the title of a book written by Julian Jackson, who's a great historian of 20th century France, about collaboration and resistance in Vichy France. And I've been to Vichy France various times. One of my great friends who just unfortunately passed away last September 12th, Dominique Catifa, I'll never get over that. I was up there visiting him about a year ago, August, and we were walking around and thinking about what transpired there. And I read a book called Vichy contre Vichy, Vichy against Vichy, written by somebody else from Vichy. Catifa was from Vichy. And I got interested in writing about La Milice. Now, La Milice was an organization. It was the French Gestapo, basically. It was an organization that was created in January 1943. It built upon two previous organizations that supported the so-called National Revolution, which was anti-Semitic and authoritarian and anti-parliamentarian and all that, of the awful Marshal Pétain, and the even worse Pierre Laval. By the way, Pierre Laval, who was executed after the war, when they decide to send the Jews, both French Jews and non-French Jews, to the camps, men and women, Pierre Laval said, send the children too. So you can imagine why he was executed, taking an oath to Hitler, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, the Milice were collaborationists. They were at first just in the south of France, and they tortured, pillaged and killed and worked alongside the Gestapo. And I became interested in who was in the Milice and what did they do? Were they townspeople? Well, many were. I won't name them all. There were thousands of them, but in which département in France were they particularly active, particularly horrific? So I've been writing this book, and I have a draft now, a reasonable draft of the book. And it's my virus book, I guess. And I will, when I go home to France again, at the end of next month, I hope, then I can finish up some of the stuff that should be done there. And so that's the book. And what happens to these people?
John, can I stop you for just a second?
Yeah.
Could you, just in case that, maybe some don't know, could you describe what the Vichy regime was? What happened there?
Okay. France is invaded by the Germans in 1940. And Marshal Pétain, who was the hero of Verdun, the great, tragic but great battle in 1916 in the east of France that saved, kept the Germans from breaking through. He becomes the head of the French government, with Pierre Laval, who was from Auvergne, becoming the chief of the government. And it was a collaborationist government. And the word collaboration, which before that meant you collaborated with somebody on an article, it took on a sinister tone, which it still has today. They are collaborating actively with the Nazis. They are rounding up communists. They are rounding up Jews. They are turning them over to the Gestapo, or they are killing them themselves. And they called it the National Revolution. And it was authoritarian. To repeat myself, it was anti-parliamentarianism. It was It was xenophobic. It was anti-Semitic. They run France between 1940 and 1944. But by the end, there's resistance to these people. And by it begins really as early as 1941. The first German is shot dead at the Metro Barbès-Rochechouart in Paris. And then a German soldier is killed at Nantes. And then it goes on from there. And there are always reprisals, bloody reprisals lots of hostages killed. But really by 1943, in the south of France, particularly in the last half of 1943, the Maquis, as they were called, the resistors, the name comes from a thick brush you find in Corsica. You can find it down where we live in the south as well. The Maquis, the resistors, really rule, at least at night. And so, and there are a lot of terrible stories, a lot of tragedies, but they begin to attack the collaborators who are helping the Germans, helping the Gestapo, and the Milice are helping the Gestapo. And they move into the Milice, move in to the north. But if you woke up in France, in the south of France, and you found a K on your front door, a K, there are no French words for K. In Breton, there are, and in German, obviously, the word in Alsace, German K for collaborator. You better get the F out of there, or they're going to come and get you, because they start blowing these people away. And again, every time you do this, that there are reprisals that come along. But gradually, there are more and more resistors and more Maquis, and they begin going after the Milice. Most of the collaborators who are killed are men. But in a few cases, there's women. There's a woman who was killed in the Ardèche, the northern part of our department, which is, we live in the southeast, way right next to the Gard. But there was a woman who denounced, this was a time of letters of denunciation. She denounced two resistors who were executed. And one day she goes to market, she's carrying her panier, her basket to go shopping. She walks across the bridge, across the Rhone, to the market in another département, the Drôme, and she turns the corner and they blow her head off. And again, they're risking reprisals. They're gonna be hostages and gonna be shootings after that. So the people that I am writing this book about are in the Milice. They're collaborators, and they're not all just men. There are some women involved too. And a lot of them get theirs toward the end of the war. And one of the tragedies, but not, and one of the things that's not too surprising, is that many of these, the people in the Milice, from departments all over the place. In 1944, they better get the hell out of there. And that's what they do. They start packing up, and these convoys are leaving France. And where are they going? They're going across the Rhine River. And a lot of these, the men end up fighting alongside German soldiers on the Eastern Front. The guy who's not the star of my book, because he's an odious guy from near Bourg-en-Bresse, called Joseph Darnon. He's the leader of the Milice. And he goes off and joins the Waffen-SS, you know, the Charlemagne division. He takes an oath to Adolf Hitler. And when things are falling apart, he tries to get the hell out. And he goes into Italy, tries to get into Swiss, but Swiss won't take him. And he tries to get to Latin America. That's where a lot of these war criminals end up. In many cases, thanks to the Americans, if they turn over a few communist names, well, you can have a nice life in Paraguay. But he's on a boat trying to go to Latin America, and the British catch him. And his next residence is the prison of La Santé in Paris. And he's put on trial, and he's executed in October 1944. So that's the, writing about la Milice. That's what I'm doing.
So why the collaboration with the Nazis? Why was there a conservative group and a progressive group that were at odds in France, and one thought that the Germans had the answer? Or
no, absolutely. I mean, the right wing in France, the 1920s and 30s is the Europe of dictatorships. Of the agrarian right-wing parties in Eastern Europe, of Hitler, and Mussolini was on the cover of Time magazine 8 different times. You know, Franco wins the Spanish Civil War, and the Franquist hordes massacre 150,000 people in the bullrings. I remember when Franco died, I was in Paris in 1975, and we drank to that. It's unusual to drink to someone's death. And at the same time in Barcelona, they were garroting, strangling anarchists in Barcelona. And so it was a Europe of dictatorship. And the Popular Front in France from 1936, really to 1937, is something very important in the collective memory of France. Paid vacations, the Louvre being open on Sunday, but much more than that. It was a time of great hope. But the French right, there were fascists all over France from in the 1920s and above all the 1930s. There were royalist groups. The great writer Charles Maurras was a royalist. He was a royalist. There was the Croix de Feu. These were former, these anciens combattants who were former war veterans. Not all war veterans were right-wing nuts, but a lot of them, you know, became socialists and communists. But the fall of France gave these people what they wanted on a plateau, on a platter. They gave them a dictatorship, an authoritarian regime. They gave them a xenophobic regime, an anti-Semitic regime. Léon Blum, who was the Jewish prime minister at the time of the front, the Popular Front, 1936, was once pulled out of a car on the Rue des Écoles and almost beaten to death by French rightists who were shouting "Better Hitler than Blum," because Léon Blum was Jewish. So there were lots of these right-wing groups. You know, if you think of, you know, France and the French economy, it's very much tied to luxury goods. It's tied to luxury goods like fancy handbags and perfumes and champagne. I'm a champagne guy myself. But if you next time you buy a bottle of champagne, don't buy Tattinger or don't buy Henriot, because those are right wing big money people funneling money to these right wing anti-Semitic groups. Same thing for perfume. I don't buy perfume, but you know, I've tried sometimes for my daughter or my late wife to buy perfume, but I don't think about perfume. But Coty, C-O-T-Y, the big right wing money. Going in to fund these groups. And they tried, there was a big demonstration on February 6, 1934, and they go charging across from the Place de la Concorde, you know, in a vigorous attempt to basically to overthrow the government. And this leads to the Popular Front, because people are afraid of fascism. Hitler came to power January 30th, 1933. Mussolini came to power in 1922. And before that, his squadron were killing communists and beating up strikers and this sort of thing. So, the right wing was very powerful in France. It wasn't dominant. Most people didn't want a right wing. You know, at Hyde Park, you had Oswald Mosley, who was a fascist, you know, giving his speeches in Hyde Park. There was an election in the Netherlands, which is always a reasonable place. 8% of the population of the voters voted for a fascist called Muster. You had a big fascist in presence in Brussels, in Belgium, a guy called Léon de Grelle. He died on the Costa Brava. They all die on the Costa Brava. The Minister of Jewish Affairs, who was an odious bastard during the time of Vichy, a guy called de Pellepoix. He wasn't really a noble, but he took this title to himself. He dies on the Costa Brava, all welcomed by Franco. Oh, you're anti-Semitic. Oh, you're for authoritarian government. Come to Spain and be well, be happy. So it's a complicated story. But I'm writing about these collaborators who are in the milice.
Mm-hmm. Well, as a historian, I know you're great at making connections, because that's what historians do, right? And I'm wondering what you think about some of the things you're talking about that were happening then, and kind of the environment that we see today in both France and the United States, and if you see any parallels there, or it's yes. Completely different.
Yes, I'm glad you asked me that question. Yeah, I was out in Oregon, where I'm from, as you kindly said, giving a talk, I don't know, a year or so ago at some fancy club, about populism. And populism is just like in the interwar period. Europe is in agricultural depression the entire time in the 1920s and 30s. It's in total economic depression, that is industrial depression, in all the years except for 1924 to 1929. It's in hard times when people start looking for scapegoats, and they start, you know, blaming the Jews, or in Eastern Europe, you're Romanian, you're blaming the Hungarian. If you're a Hungarian, you're blaming everybody because you lost 2/3 of your land after World War I. And so part of populism and this stereotyping your enemies is part of populism. And what do you see in the United States today? it's exactly the same thing. I mean, the base of Donald Trump's support is populism. I'm a big sports guy, but I'm not a NASCAR person, so I shouldn't probably say it's NASCAR dads. It's white NASCAR dads. It's also females too, but it's a populism, and it's this kind of racism. I live in a community here, you know, of waving my hand, but in North Haven, which voted for Trump for, you know, last two elections, overwhelmingly, there's this place that is full of racists, and it's part of the surge of populism. And if you go, you know, again, talking about Poland, we see this in Poland now, anti-immigrant fervor in Poland. Hungary's even worse. Hungary is retreating really to the fascism. Poland's not returning to fascism. It's a right-wing Catholic conservatism. Hungary, where one of my best friends lives in Hungary, and I go to Hungary fairly often, is retreating to the fascism of the 1930s. And you see these tendencies in Slovakia, you see them in Slovenia, and you see them in lots of other places. So, and you see them in the United States. So the continuities are really there. Look at the January 6th or whatever it was, and all the people, all the Trump people, you know, storming the Capitol, and that has its antecedents in the 20s and 30s. And part of fascism, you know, is a generic term, counting National Socialism, counting Frankism, counting all these other, you know, right-wing movements, is violence. It's violence. And these are people who, the German soldiers in the Freikorps, drilling in their basements in the early 1920s, they just keep right on marching. And you can look at the whole period, 1914 to 1945, is a new and more terrible 30 years war, like the 17th century, but much, much worse in every case. So the populist continuities are really there, the kind of violence of the Proud Boys, the violence of all these groups.
John, what do you think the answer is so that we don't continue in this cycle, or is that just human nature?
I don't know if I have an answer. I think what's obvious, the biggest risk in the United States, and I'm not an expert in the United States at all. I feel more at home in France because I spent more of my adult life in France than I have in this country. But the biggest threat in this country is right-wing extreme movements. There's just no question about that. And they can lie and say it's these Antifa people, or they make up all these stories, but they basically have to be crushed like grapes. They have to be put in a position where they can't be bringing violence into the public sphere as much as they already have. And you know, January 6th, wasn't it the 6th? Yeah. Was really a warm up, and there will be other occasions, other events, and that's scary. And this is another of these continuities from the 1920s and 1930s, from Mussolini's Squadri in the early 1920s to Hitler's SS and SA, to the Frankist squads, it's a mess. So we just cross our fingers and hope for the best, and hope this will continue in many ways to be a reasonable place.
Yeah, yeah. Well, John, thank you very much. We're right at, 8:30 here, 7:30. No, I don't know what it's 8:30 in Sacramento, I guess, isn't it? So it must be 11:30 there. I don't know if anybody has any quick questions for John. Is there?
Thank you for listening to me, everybody.
Oh, thank you so much. Do you have a minute to hang out, or do you need to?
Absolutely.
Okay. Megan, you have something?
Yeah, so I'm a big history person. I love history class. I actually took so many. I'm about to have my degree in it. But I'm really into the book that you're writing, and I was just curious, do you have an ETA of when it'll be released, or are you still just writing on it?
No, I'm just writing on it. You know, I don't have much control over who publishes my book. Books. I have someone, people who represent me, and I didn't know the word agented until about 10 years ago. But what they do is they, put out my books, and hopefully somebody will buy them. Somebody does buy them, and so I don't know. There's a there's a it, you know, if you're, if it's an academic book, it was with university press. University presses have trade divisions, so you can do a, you know, a trade book with Oxford University Press or Yale University Press. But my last couple books have been published by trade publishers who tend to get them out quicker. They get them out in about 6 to 8 months as opposed to about, you know, 2 years with academic presses. You know, this book is not ready to go. But the people that kindly represent me will hopefully sell this to somebody. But you're kind to ask about this. You know, the person that represents me, he doesn't really anymore, but it's one of my great friends, is a guy called Don Lamb, who for me incarnates, you're interested in history and you're getting a degree in history. So you like books, you love books, and you probably like me, like to hold books and not just read everything online. And Don Lamb was my publisher at W.W. Norton and Company, where he was the president and CEO, and Norton is a big publisher. And he signed me up to do History of Modern Europe, and I did another book for them too. And then he went on, after denouncing agents, he went on to be my agent. And now he's not doing it anymore, but the people that with whom he worked, you know, represent me, and they will sell the book to somebody. Don Lamb is 89 and still skiing. And he still cares about books. He taught a couple college seminars at Yale on publishing, which were great. So congratulations on your interest in history. It's very nice to know that.
Thank you. I can't stand reading books electronically. I'm trying to get adapted to it because that's how books are coming on nowadays. But I'm one of those people, I like to have it in my hands and I like to write my notes. And history books is where I started with that, because that's what my English professor and my high school, actually, we had to call them professors, but that's what she taught me to do, is when you have a book, to write your little side notes on a post-it in order for you to do that. And yes, I am driving. I'm not driving, I'm parked. it's really nice to listen to a history professor who has so much knowledge and has seen those things. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
No, thanks. Well, I care about books and I care about people who read books. So that's great.
Any other questions for John tonight before we end? John, I usually ask our guests what their favorite dessert is. Do you have a favorite dessert?
Tarte tatin.
Oh.
Tarte tatin is like a pineapple upside down cake, except it's apples, it's caramelized apples, and it becomes perfection when you sprinkle Armagnac on it. So that's my favorite dessert.
That sounds amazing.
The better. There we go.
That sounds amazing. Okay, you guys, there you go. There's your code word for tonight.
Tarte tatin, T-A-R-T-E for tarte, which means pie, and then tatin, T-A-T-I-N, because that was the name of the woman who supposedly invented this in the west of France.
Wow. Oh. Okay. You may have, so you have, might have to look that up. Guys. All right. Thank you so much. Everyone, this was the last lecture in our series. I know this will be up on, we'll have this up online for you to take a look at later on if you like. And I know other students will be there too. John, thanks so much for joining us tonight.
Thank you all for coming to listen to me, or staying up to listen to me. And Steve, thank you so much for inviting me. I appreciate it greatly. Keep in touch, Steve. We'll keep in touch.
Okay. Yeah.
Bartlesville, Oklahoma, right?
That's my hometown.
That's right. Where my cousins lived, you know.
Yeah. That was just an amazing connection that anybody else has to connect. Knows Bartlesville.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you. Merci. Bonne soirée. Bye-bye.
Goodbye. Thank you.
Hey, Dr. Thompson, I have a question.
Yeah. Hi, Teddy.
Hey, how you doing? So I had a question about discussion 11 for the musicianship. It seems like it's been closed since it was posted last week. I was just wondering, are you going to open that up, or should I just not worry about it, or what do you think?
Is it not working? Can't get into it at all?
Yeah, you can't get into it at all. I think last week when it was posted, it was closed, and then it just never opened. Like today, when you posted for discussion 12, it was posted as open.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Well, I just was hoping to get my points from that.
Yeah. No, I get you. What I'll do then is I'll put an announcement up tomorrow. I'll reopen that board, and we'll have it open through Sunday or something, and you guys can post to both of them this week, and we'll make it up that way.
Perfect. I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, Teddy. Mm-hmm. Okay, Zoe and Sharon, unless you have some questions, I'm going to take off. Zoe, it looks like you have a question. I saved last week's lecture and I can't seem to find it in Canvas. You mean your response to the lecture? If that's the case, then go in and post it again. It'll be okay. All right. Hope you got that. Where did I post? Last week's lecture? It's on the Mozart site. You mean lecture number 8? With Natsuki? Yeah, it's there on the Mozart Project site. Do you need me to send you a link? Okay. Send me an email. And then I'll respond with the website. Oh, okay. How did you find the Zoom link for this? Is it with posted in Canvas? Okay. Okay. So send me an email. I'll shoot back the website to you. It's just Mozart Project ARC Orchestra. If you Google that, it'll come right up too. So you can do that as well. But if you don't find it, then send me an email. Okay. Good night, Zoe.